And he breathed into us the breath of life. Hallelujah. So that it would never have to be again by might or by power, but by his Spirit. Praise God. We thank you for your Spirit this morning, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the breath of life, the very breath of God that is in each and every one of us as believers, that makes us more than overcomers, more than conquerors in every situation, in every circumstance. We bless your name, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Almighty, King of the universe. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome all of you here this morning. And everybody joining us on Facebook, online, on the internet, however you're doing it. Praise the Lord. We appreciate you being part of the service today. God bless all of you that are here in person. Praise the Lord. I almost said in the flesh, but I hope not. Praise God. We're in spirit and in truth. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you all. Appreciate it. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. It was awesome. Amen. Great time Friday night. Y'all need to be here and be part of that. There was such a sweet spirit to me. I just felt there was such a peace throughout that entire service, and I was really blessed. Praise the Lord. It was a good time, amen. It always is when the people of God get together, and amen. Peter. The Lord. I'm ready. Praise the Lord. Because I go home to work, so praise God. Maybe a little selfish on my part, but amen. God bless you again. Thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing. Everybody that did, we appreciate it so much. It just opens things up for the Holy Spirit to be able to minister and move and do what only He can do. Amen. Quicken things to each one of us. And so praise the Lord. Excited about that. I think, you know, one of the things God's been dealing with me about recently, especially recently, is about our being one. And, you know, I mean that in every way. Because God, I'm telling you, the enemy is coming to divide us. I'm talking about husbands and wives, children, that's what he does. He wants division. Because anywhere he can get strife going, he can create a situation where the Holy Spirit has difficulty reaching us. Not that the Holy Spirit has a problem with it. We have a problem with it. And so that just doubles down when it comes to the church body itself. And I'm thinking, you know, Suzanne she's in for some crap. She hasn't already figured that out. I know she has. But the prophets were always misunderstood. And I mean, that can be, even within the body of Christ, we can sometimes not quite be on the same page. I know it happens to me. I've just learned that, hey, let God do this, because he's the only one that really knows what's going on. And so we need to recognize that each one of us has giftings, and we need to love each other. I'm telling you, we're at a time now where this is not just BS, it's not just Christianese, it's a fact, it's what we have to do. We have to come together, we have to be supportive of one another, we have to be respectful to one another, we have to love each other. And sometimes it's easier here than it is at home. Say praise the Lord, Sarah. Yes, he does, amen. I'm just saying, we all know this, if you've been married more than 3 months, hallelujah, it can be a challenge. And God knows why, because that home is the thing that he established everything else to work out of. Amen. We have a family in God. And so it's important that we recognize these are not just random things anymore. It isn't just, you know, you get ticked off because of what was for dinner, you know, which that doesn't happen. I never say anything about that, because I know if I do, there won't be any dinner tomorrow. Praise the Lord. If But no, Sally's a great cook, so I'm fortunate there. But you know what I'm saying. If you're married, you know there's always little things that can trip your trigger, and the enemy will be sure to find something to create anything to cause issues. Amen? And it's because God has a plan for you, and it isn't independent of that mate. He sees us as one. Even though we often see ourselves as totally opposites, God sees us as one. So we have to be able to cooperate with each other in order to cooperate with God. And sometimes that's the first step in submission, you know, in submission to God, is submitting ourselves one to another. And I'm not talking about wives, submit yourselves to your husbands, because we know husbands, somebody give me an amen. There's some submitting that goes on our part too. There has to be in order for anything to be successful. And so praise the Lord. Anyway, that's just a random thought on my part because it's been on my heart. And I know that God's, look, in those days when God moved mightily, the people came together first before God would show up in any, you know, in a manifest way corporately. Now, we may all get individual, interactions with the Holy Spirit, but God's wanting to do something powerful through a magnified group, through a multiplied body. And for that to happen, we've got to love one another. Amen. In every area, we've got to be submitted to the authorities that God places over us. Amen. And I'm telling you, Suzanne's got a gifting. We may not always understand it. You don't have to. The prophets many times didn't even understand their own gifting. I mean, look at Daniel, and there's many times where God is downloading to them, and they're trying to do their best. Amen. But just trust the Lord. He knows what he's doing. Amen. So, praise God. And I just believe that there'll be more people that will stand, have the courage of the Holy Spirit to do what Suzanne has done, and that's just stand up and say, I believe God is telling me that I need to do this. I'm not saying everybody's going to stand up and say, I'm a prophet, but there's callings. There's lots of callings. And God wants every one of those offices to be filled in order for the church to function in its fullness. And so, praise the Lord. Amen. God is good. Amen. And he has blessed us, amen, with prophets. Listen, there's churches that don't have a prophet. There's churches that don't have anything like that, that are way bigger than this church in terms of numbers. So we ought to be, thank God that he has looked on us and said, hey, I think they'll respond. I think they'll listen. I think they'll do what I'm telling them to do. Amen. So thank God for that. Yes, Peter. Yes.
You know, God's going to use you to speak to somebody that nobody else would have.
That's right.
And it's going to be within the church. It's going to be without this church. And there are too many churches that are, unfortunately, like the Pharisees and Sadducees, that only feel that the only people that they use are leadership.
Right.
Yeah.
But, you know, if we can't be that way.
Well, he said the least shall lead us sometimes, amen. I'm proof of that, amen, if I'm doing any kind of leading.
For being that way. Thank you for being open.
I appreciate it, Peter. But we've all had experiences like that. I know Sally and I had one in particular that stands out in our mind, and we won't say anything about where it was, but it was a young girl, a teenage girl, young teenager, like 13 or 14 years old, that stood up and talked about a mission trip that they had been on and the people they saw healed and delivered and set free, and these young people were just excited. They were nearly about to flip out, you know, because of the experience they'd had in the Holy Spirit. And in that same church, they had passed out papers saying, don't pray for anybody unless you're on the team. It's a large group. I mean, it was a large, several hundred, I mean, 500-600 people, I expect, at least. But anyway, I thought, boy, if God didn't just slap them upside the head. Because this was after all of that, after all of this, and they had their own little team of 3 or 4 people that prayed and so on and so forth. And there's nothing wrong with that, but we all know everybody in here prays. Everybody in here needs to be praying. If God speaks to your heart, you know, to pray for somebody or to give them a word of knowledge or whatever it might be, you need to do that. But this, I thought, what a shame, because they had hundreds of people there that no doubt were believers that had the potential for doing all kinds of ministry there. And yet they had dumbed it down to like a half a dozen people on that team. And then this young girl, after all of that, this little girl gets up there and tells them the truth, that God will use anybody. That was her exact word. She said, what we learned on that mission trip was that God will use anybody, even a little 13-year-old girl. So, I mean, I thought of all the wisdom that they thought they had in their leadership, and it took a 13-year-old to explain it to them. Praise the Lord. Absolutely. They just had childlike faith. They just believed that God would do what he said he would do. Hallelujah. So anyway, praise the Lord. We've all had experiences like that, and those are the things that hopefully teach us that going forward, we need everybody. We need everybody, and we need everybody all the time. Praise the Lord. So thank the Lord. Amen. God bless you all again for being here. Let's go right to the Word of God. I want to go to Exodus chapter 34 and read Exodus 34, verses 27 through 29. Exodus 34, 27 through 29. Praise the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, write thou these words, for after the tenor of these words I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water, and he wrote upon the tables, that the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. And it came to pass, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, and when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. Verse 35. And the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone, and Moses put the veil upon his face again, until he went in to speak with him. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 through 18. Praise the Lord. 'Seeing then we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. We all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into that same image from glory to glory, even as the Spirit of the Lord. Praise God. Now, eventually I'm going to get to this place, but I just want to say right now, I think it's in Luke 24 or 28, somewhere in there. Anyway, remember when Jesus comes and shows himself to a couple of the disciples on the road to Emmaus after his crucifixion, after his resurrection, and they didn't recognize him. And he speaks to him anyway. You know, we think of always Jesus' death, burial, resurrection, bang, he's gone. And then 50 days later is the Pentecost. The truth is there was 40 days. Jesus showed himself for 10 days or so, or for 10 days after his resurrection. People were raised. There were people coming out of the graves. There was all kinds of stuff. Jesus showed himself to these guys on the road to Emmaus. He meets with the disciples when Thomas says, unless I put my hand in his side and all that. That was 8 days after the resurrection. It actually says that was 8 days. So this 40 days that Moses is dealing with is significant, because we're seeing the same thing after Jesus' resurrection. And he comes forth, and he's not recognized either, because he had for whatever reason, he made himself unrecognizable to those immediate disciples of his who were on the road to Emmaus. But it's interesting that once he starts giving them the word, he becomes recognizable again. Praise the Lord. So we'll get to that at some point here too. But I just want, here's my question first off, and it's rhetorical obviously, but why were there 10 commandments given on two tablets? The double, I was thinking as soon as Suzanne brought that up again. Amen. The first tablet was a commandment for the relationship between God and man. And the second tablet, or the second tablet of commandments, was for the relationship between man and man. So initially there's one for us and how we relate to God, and then there's one for how we relate to each other. Look at Matthew chapter 22, verse 36 through 39. Matthew 22, 36 through 39. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So Jesus used the great commandment to summarize both tablets. Amen. That those tablets that Moses received from God on Sinai, Jesus gave this one commandment to represent both tablets of the Ten Commandments. Amen. So why is it love? Why love above everything else? You know, you think with Jesus, all the things that he did, all that he knew, all of his knowledge, all of his understanding, that he would dumb everything down. I mean, I'm talking humanly speaking, to just this one commandment, or these two commandments, so to speak. Love. In other words, he basically said love's everything. Right? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 13. Now abideth faith, hope, and love. That word charity, obviously, most of you know this anyway. It translates love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. So here's the deal. He's telling us that when God's kingdom comes to its fullness. Now we know that the kingdom has been preached, and many of us have received the kingdom. But are we mature in that kingdom? And this is partly what Suzanne's talking about, to my way of understanding. What God is saying to us is, yes, you have the Holy Spirit. Yes, you have the gifting. Yes, you have the kingdom of God has been preached to you, and you have access to that. But are you really living in it as mature people? I mean, are you really taking advantage of everything that's made available to you through that, right? Well, here's what he's saying. He said, when that kingdom of God comes fully, when we are fully activated and fully operating in it, faith and hope are fulfilled. They're satisfied. Amen. You only need faith in what you don't see. Amen. And you only need hope in promises that are yet to be fulfilled. Right? Look at Hebrews 11:1. By faith, he says, praise the Lord. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Well, once that's fulfilled, we no longer have need of hope because our faith has fully completed whatever it is we're believing for. Our faith has manifested. Amen? So here's the deal. When the Lord comes, now that means when he comes in the future, the second coming, and when he comes fully to us today. Our love will not diminish. It will increase. Praise the Lord. Faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these, he said, is love. Why? Because it lasts forever. You won't need faith in heaven. You won't need hope in heaven. But love will dominate heaven because, amen, 1 John 4:8-11. God is love. Amen. Love lasts forever. Love is eternal because God is eternal. Now faith, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. We're supposed to love like Jesus. Praise the Lord. I feel like Joyce Meyer. Can't help myself. Praise the Lord. This isn't normal for me, but I'm going to move past this, but this is important. I'm telling you, it is. Sally's saying, yeah, I know. Don't. Praise the Lord. Look, here's the deal. I'm talking about Nathan. Normal Nathan. Natural Nathan. Jesus. That was like an amen in tongues. I'm not a great expresser of love except with grandkids and great-grandkids. It's just not my nature. I wasn't raised that way. We were very, I don't want to say cold, but just kind of distant and yes or no sir kind of stuff. It's not my nature to be cuddly and warm and, you know what I mean? Fuzzy, yeah. Furry maybe, but not fuzzy, praise the Lord. And it isn't that I don't love, it's just that it's awkward for me. It's uncomfortable for me to be real expressive of that. I'm telling you, y'all don't really know Nathan before Jesus, but hey, I was not a hugger. I'm telling you, it was hard to get a handshake out of me because I'm judging, I'm figuring, you know, you're going to grab me with one hand, punch me with the other, or pick my pocket, or what's going to happen here. So, I mean, that's just, this is me saying, okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you like Suzanne's saying, okay, I'm going to do this. It's awkward, it's uncomfortable. I mean, I can tell you, I'm telling you the truth, my mother, as much as I know she loved us kids, when I got born again, when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it just came on me to just want to love people. I'm telling you the truth. And I would hug and so forth. When we first came back from Texas, first vacation that we took after having received the baptism of the Holy Spirit was a year or so. And I came home, and the first thing I did when I walked into my mother's home was give her a hug. And I'm telling you, it was like grabbing a piece of granite. She didn't know what to make of this because it's just not something we did. I mean, you gave the obligatory kiss goodnight, and it was on the cheek, and it was kind of just a, you know, brush and then get on to bed or whatever it was. That's just the way it was. And again, I'm not saying they didn't love us. I'm just saying that's the way they were raised. That's the way they understood. They expressed their love by providing and doing other things. But that wasn't normal. So for me, I had to overcome some stuff, praise the Lord. And it still rears its ugly head sometimes in personal situations, probably more than others. But I have to constantly be checking myself. You know, is this Nathan, as Tim would say, BC or AD? You know, I mean, how am I behaving here? So let's look at this again. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1. You know, it's got to be about me. I can't get up here without it. Here, look at me. I'm special. Hallelujah. Glory to God. This is one of the things I'm learning and have learned over the years, but really, honest to God, in the last year, I have found more intimacy with the Lord than I've ever had. But it wasn't that God didn't bless me. It wasn't that I didn't know and have interaction with the Lord. But I've learned a personal, it's not wrong for me to be greedy with God. I mean, in fact, the Lord just told me that day before yesterday. I was praying about something. He said, hey, why don't you talk to me like, you know, we're somebody that we have a relationship here? I mean, because I'm kind of usually yes, sir, that kind of stuff. I mean, not sir, but you know what I mean, almost King James kind of prayer. And the Lord just rebuked me and just said, come on, man. I'm your Abba, you know. You can talk to me. And so, I mean, it really, and I'll tell you what, I got an immediate fulfillment of something that I had been praying about. And it was just like God saying, see, son, when you let me love you, There's a thing that opens, a gate that opens, there's a flow that happens that you can't experience otherwise. So that's why I'm talking on the one hand about love here this morning, praise the Lord. But anyway, in 1 Corinthians 13, 1, he says, though I speak with the tongue of men and of angels and have not love, I become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. Verse 8. Love never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. But love won't. Love is the one thing that's constant and eternal. We won't always need prophecy. We won't always need tongues. I think in heaven we'll be speaking in tongues. We'll be speaking whatever language God wants to speak. But you know what I'm saying, tongues and interpretation, these things, we need them now because it's an avenue just like prophecy or anything else. It's a portal. It's a means by which God can come and interact with us. When we get in person, face to face with God, when we're one with Him in heaven, none of that's necessary anymore. The only thing that will be necessary then will be love. Praise the Lord. Romans 8, verse 37 through 39. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So the power of those two tablets and the great commandment is love. The power of all that download that God gave to Moses and the great commandment, Jesus says, that fulfills all the rest of it is love. Exodus 32, verse 15 and 16. Exodus 32, 15 and 16. So Moses turned and he went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides, and on the one side and on the other side were they written. The tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God, graven upon the tablets or tables. Two tables, and they're the work of God, right? Look at verse 19. Two tables, two tablets. God wrote it. It's the work of God. Came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp that he saw the calf, the idol, the dancing. And Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand, and he broke them beneath the mount. Praise God. Shattered. So Moses had to be thinking, you ever had a really powerful encounter with God and then step out into the world and see a total separation? Praise the Lord. Moses had to be thinking, his time on the mountain, this had to have been the spiritual high point. I mean, he's there for 40 days, face to face with God. And God's given him the whole Torah. A breakthrough, man. I mean, this is an incredible moment. All that he'd been through, the people saying, how'd you bring us out here to kill us? And, you know, everything, they're ranting and raving, the Red Sea. They're saying, oh, my God, why did you just leave us where we were? You brought us out here for Pharaoh to kill us or drown. And all of the animosity, everything that he went through, everything they'd put up with, this was the turning point. I'm sure that's what he thought. Now, God. 40 days with you, and I got everything that you want us to do, man. We got it now. We're going to make it. We're going to do all right. We're going to be good, right? And he comes down, and what happens? It's like nothing happened. The people literally shattered his expectations. But look at Exodus 34, verse 1. The Lord said unto Moses, hew these two tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest. Hallelujah. Now, I know everybody in here has got it together. Praise the Lord. We don't make mistakes. We don't fail. We have no flaws. You know, we're there, right? Standing on the mountain. Okay. But I'm sure there's some people out there that we don't know on Facebook that have issues, that maybe struggle with times of failure, times of doubt, times of uncertainty, and times of coming short of God's expectation, and our own, for that matter. Amen? What does God do when we basically break the laws? He gives us a second chance. Over and over, He gives us second chances. He is the God of second chances. Think about Peter, perfect example. He denied the Lord. I don't know Him. In fact, he didn't just say, I don't know Him. I don't know Him. He started swearing to prove that he didn't know Him. You know, I mean, you know, if I knew Him, I wouldn't be cussing talking like this, would I? I don't know this guy, you know. So he decided, what does he decide to do? Because he was so crushed by his doubt and fear, what did he do? He said, I'm going back to my old life. He's doing the same thing the Israelites did. Let's just go back to Egypt. Why? What the heck was going on in their head? I'll tell you, and I'm going to get to this in a minute, but imagination. They imagined it not to be as bad as it actually was, or they couldn't have ever said, let's go back. I mean, come on, let's go back to the leeks and the garlic, and right? And Peter said, I'm going fishing, boys. I'm going to go back and be what I was. I'm just going to go back and do what I did. But Jesus gave him a second chance. Praise the Lord. Look at John chapter 2, excuse me, 21, 15 through 17. I'm going to skip the whole story. I think you all know it. He says, let's go fishing. The boys come along, they all decide to go fishing. They're out there trying to go back to their old life, but it won't produce a thing. They can't catch any fish. They're out there doing what they were trained for, what their whole life had been about, but it's not producing a thing except more disappointment, more discouragement. And so Jesus says, hey, boys, did you catch anything? I'm just paraphrasing now what I left out so we didn't have to read it all. And they say, oh, we caught nothing. He said, well, try fishing over here for a minute. And they catch a bunch of fish. And Jesus, they come to the shore, and Jesus is cooking up some fish, fixing a meal for them. And he says to Peter, when they were eating, after they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than these? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he says unto him, feed my lambs. Verse 17. I'm sorry, 16. He saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he says unto him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said, feed my sheep. And then 17, he says unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love you. And Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. So Jesus is kind of saying to Peter what the Lord said to me. He's saying one kind of love, and I'm saying another. You know, there's the agape, and he's asking him, do you love me completely? Am I the extent or the end of where your love goes? Or am I just somebody that's lovable? And it takes Peter twice before he can actually say, Lord, yes, I love you. I love you with eternal love, with God kind of love. Praise the Lord. God is love. And those two tablets are connected to love. And God, He demonstrated His love when He forgave Israel. Okay, we'll make two more. We'll just do it again. And He did the same thing for Peter when He said, I still love you, Peter. Nothing's changed. I'm saying to anybody and to everybody, and to myself included, we don't have to live in guilt. We don't have to live in shame. We don't have to feel like a failure because we failed. We don't have to feel like we're under a cloud of judgment because we blew it. Just ask for the second chance. He delights in do-overs. He loves to show himself the lover. The second set of the Ten Commandments were, they were put in the ark. Right? You remember the story. He put the tables of stone in there with the ark and the manna, pot of the manna that they had, and Aaron's rod. Right? Those were all in the Ark of the Covenant. You ever wonder what he did with those first stones that were broken? I mean, it kind of made me wonder. I mean, after all, God did write them. Even if they were broken, they would have been something to me. I would have thought they'd be of value. Well, the Jewish tradition says that those broken pieces of the first were put in the ark as well. Why? Because, I mean, most of us, broken stuff is broken stuff. You just move on, right? Especially if you get something to replace it with. But the belief is brokenness precedes wholeness. You can't really be whole until you know that you've been broken. You know that, in other words, you can't be fixed if you don't know you need to be fixed. We can get so full of ourselves and so full of pride that we can't admit that was not good. That was a poor choice. That was a bad thing to say. That was, right? It ought to make us better. It shouldn't depress us. Hallelujah. It ought to develop us. That's what Jesus was doing with Peter. He didn't shame him. He just wanted to get him to understand, hey, you've got a choice here, and you can love or you cannot. I'm not holding anything against you. So there's no reason why you can't love me the same way I love you. Every time just think about it. Every time the Ark of the Covenant was moved from one place to the next, every time it traveled, the people could hear the rattling of those broken pieces inside the ark. It was a reminder that brokenness and wholeness can and will coexist until Jesus comes and wipes it all away. Anybody not know that? That you can have failure and success in the same vessel? That you can be more than a conqueror having just been conquered? Our brokenness and our wholeness can coexist by faith in the love of God. I can be imperfect and still lay hands on the sick and see him recover. I can be flawed and still give a word of prophecy and testimony. I can be not exactly everything that God has declared me to be and still give a word of knowledge. Because of his love. Because of his perfection. Those two sets of tablets, they're symbolically pointing us to Jesus and to the finished work. The first set point to the first coming, right? The word that became flesh. And then it was broken. The first set of tablets. The second set of tablets had to be made because of our sin. Because of our failure. He was broken so we could experience forgiveness and receive the divine do-over. Praise the Lord. We look at things and we think, oh man, how horrible. In the mind of God, it's just part of a process. Do you think with all the time and energy, you know, you can use human terms, of God creating those first two tablets, 40 days, dealing with Moses, just to have them shattered in a moment. Now, if that were us, I'd still be complaining. I'd still be, you know, having a grudge over it. Not God. He just says, come on, we'll just do it again. Why? Because he knew before it ever happened. And it didn't stop him from doing it because he knew the failure. Because he can fix the failure. You don't surprise him when you screw up. Because he's already got the redemptive plan in place. He already has a means of remitting that failure. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. The smashed and the broken. See, Jesus was broken. He's like the bread of communion. He said, this is my body, broken for you. Take, eat. Take my brokenness, and it'll give you wholeness. Brokenness and wholeness can coexist, folks. It happens every day, all day long. Amen? The smashed and the broken tablets, they also point to the world that we're living in right now. We look at it and we think, my God, this thing is such a mess. It's falling to pieces. But all Jesus has to do is show up and restore it. We look at it through the natural eyes and we say, no way, it ain't going to happen. Well, I'm telling you, Jesus can fix it. He can make it whole. Exodus 32, verse 26 through 28. Exodus 32, 26 through 28. And Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. This is after the big idolatry fiasco. And he said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side, and go in and out from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. So the consequence of idolatry and rejection of God resulted in 3,000 deaths. Now, we've all heard this a lot of times, but I'm repeating it anyway for the sake of my message. Praise the Lord. So what happens on the day of Pentecost? God shows up again with a word. Amen? The word came like wind, and it rushed through, and it was like the breath of God that fell on these people, and they took the word, Jesus, and they carried it out, and Peter began to speak that word, and what happened? The scripture says about 3,000 were added that day. A do-over. Praise the Lord. Jesus was broken, and the resurrected Jesus, the second set of tablets, comes and brings back life. 3,000 are saved. Praise the Lord. And on it goes. And as a result of Israel's idolatry, judgment broke, and 3,000 died. The result of Jesus being broken, 3,000 are given life. Jesus' brokenness led to life. It brought forgiveness, not judgment. Praise the Lord. Those second set of tablets are also Jesus' second coming as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Amen. Who cuts off all false gods. Amen. Who causes the defeat of all of God's enemies. Amen. And all of God's people's enemies. Amen. Your enemies will be my enemies. Your friends, your allies will be my allies, right? Amen. Those broken pieces not only point to Jesus, but they also represent broken dreams that we have. Amen. Broken promises that we've suffered from people. Rejection. Sickness. Poverty. Amen. The Spirit of Jesus has come to deliver us today. a resurrection, amen, of everything that has been broken, everything that has been taken from us, everything that we have suffered, amen. Bring your brokenness to Him is what He's saying. Bring the broken pieces to me, amen, and watch what I'll do with it. Praise God. Matthew 26, verse 27 and 28. Matthew 26, verses 27 and 28. And He took the cup and He gave thanks and He gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Acts 2, verse 38. "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And Peter says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Hebrews chapter 10, verse 17 through 20. I knew that second one because it's the only thing I preached for 3 years. "Their sins and iniquities I will remember no more. Now, where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh." Praise the Lord. Remission has a purpose. And I'm telling you, here's what God said to me. Everybody's freaking out. Everybody's concerned. Everybody, let me just say, when I say everybody, I'm using general terms. I'm not saying everybody here. Maybe it doesn't bother you at all, but if it doesn't, then you're really unique. But there is so much crap happening that it's overwhelming people, even people of God. And He's trying to show us this is more than just me getting saved. This is more than just me having my sins forgiven. It's more than me knowing that even though I still fail, God's given me do-overs constantly. There's more to this. He's trying to get us to see through the eyes of the Spirit, to really begin to function as the Spirit being that He has created us to be. It's what Suzanne was talking about earlier, the way I received it anyway. Remission has a purpose. It manifests God's sovereignty and His dominion, amen, over all things, over everything. And it exposes the illusion of man's sovereignty and man's dominion. When you get into an encounter with God, you realize how little you really are. But it's so freeing because, yes, it strips you of your dominion and the illusion, amen, of your sovereignty, but it's good because I'm not responsible anymore. All I got to do is trust Him. He's got the authority. He's got the power. And He's given me the right to walk in that. What we're seeing is man thinking he has authority. Man thinking he has dominion. Man thinking that he has some sort of sovereignty. And you don't have to look at it for very long to know that somebody's really screwed up. Somebody's got a bad kind of idea about how things work. Amen. This remission declares that all blessings come from God. They don't come from us. They don't come from the government. They don't come from just good luck. They don't come from the casino. I'm not against any of that. I'm just saying, you better know that's not your answer. Amen. It calls us away from the physical realm. It calls us to the spiritual realm. That's the reason for remission. It isn't just so we get a pass to heaven. It's to get us into the spirit realm, to get us to think spiritually. It calls us to return to God. Illusions are exposed. Entanglements are broken. the gods, little g, and idols are judged. And they're wiped away. Even the illusions, entanglements, idols, gods, and the lives of God's own people. There's so much going on in people. They don't bow their knee to some Baal, to some idol, to some god, little g. Not intellectually, but spiritually, folks. If there's something between you and everything God wants for you, it's an idol. And I'm not trying to, look, you know me. I believe in grace to the max. But I'm telling you something that God has been telling me for the last year. And specifically for the last 6 months or more. And that is, if you've got anything in your life that hasn't been given back to God, I don't care what it is. It may not be sin. It may not keep you out of heaven. I'm not saying that. But it'll keep you from the relationship that God wants you to have with Him. It'll keep you from moving totally into the spirit realm that He has designed specifically for you. It is your destiny. Now, there's things that we can do and have that will not keep us out of heaven, that God will not judge us for, but they will stop the flow of everything God has purposed for your life. It will hinder the fullness of God's sovereignty over your life because you're still holding on to part of it. You're still under the illusion that this has enough value that it's worth keeping rather than what God wants to give me. Praise the Lord. Even when it comes in the form of judgment, that word ultimately manifests in remission. Even when God judges, it's for mercy. It draws us away from the physical and back to God. It takes us from the physical to the spirit. We just see it as, oh, well, it's punishment. No. If there is judgment, it's the way he describes it, it's like correction. It's showing my love for you. It's showing that I'm going to see to it that you don't suffer the consequences of that bad crop. That you're not going to harvest something that I don't want you to harvest. Psalms 29, verses 3 and 4. I feel almost like, I got to tell you, I feel almost like a hypocrite preaching this. But I know what God has been dealing with me and doing in my life. And I had a lot of things. In fact, even this morning I talked to the Lord and just said, you know, I'm sorry, Father, that I took for granted so much for so long. You never held me accountable. You never judged me. You never said, don't do that again. But there was a time, then at some point you just took it. I can't even take credit for being disciplined enough to not. He just took it. Because he knew. I can see his heart, but I can also see that will of his. He won't let go. So I'll just take it. That's why I would never in any way think to judge anybody else for any little thing or whatever going on in your life. That's not what I'm talking about this morning. That's between you and God. I'm saying, anything, believe me, anything you've done, I was there first. Praise the Lord. I've been there. I've done it. So I'm not, this is no way saying, no, but look at me. No, I'm saying, well, if I'm doing anything differently than I did, it's not me. It's God. It is God. It isn't like all of a sudden I got really good. It's just his goodness just overwhelmed me. Praise the Lord. So he said that in Psalms 29, verse 3, he said, the voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thundereth. The Lord is upon many waters. We know the waters represent people. Amen. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty.
The voice of the Lord. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 24, verse 15 and 16.
Now this we talked about, I was talking about it earlier just briefly, but it came to pass that while they communed together, these are the two disciples on the road to Emmaus after the resurrection of Jesus. And they're arguing about, I don't know, because they think he's dead. They haven't heard about the resurrection yet. They just assume that he's dead, and so they're broken. They think everything that he said has been wasted and nothing's going to happen like they had imagined, that it would. But anyway, they're on this road and they're talking together and they're reasoning, trying to reason this out, trying to make sense out of everything that happened. And Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But they didn't recognize him. He did something to keep them from recognizing who he was because he had a purpose in that. He didn't want them to just say, "Oh my God, it's Jesus, he's raised from the dead." No, he wanted something else to do that because he knew there were going to be people coming for centuries, for millennia, who would never see his face in the natural, but they would hear his voice and they would know that it was him. I'm feeling it. Hallelujah. So it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned Jesus himself, but their eyes were holden that they should not know him. Verse 27 through 32. In the beginning, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh, they just got even closer to him, unto the village. And where they got close to the village, whether they went, and he made us though we would have gone further. In other words, he just kept on like he was going to just keep on going, right? They're trying to get closer to him as they're getting closer to the village, and he's acting as though he's going to keep going. But they held on to him. They said, "Don't go, don't go," saying, "Abide with us, for it's toward evening, and the day is far spent." And he went in to tarry with them. Now, they still don't know who he is, but his words are just capturing them. And so they constrained him and said, "Come in." And they went in and he tarried with them. And it came to pass as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and he blessed it and he brake it to give it to them. And their eyes were opened immediately. This brokenness, this broken bread opened their eyes and they knew him and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us by the way? While he opened to us the scriptures." Now think back to Sinai. The word came with fire. Right? And it was broken. And then he does a do-over. And he gives them the word again. Right back to the word given at Sinai. Delivered from Sinai with fire. The word. In you. Alive in you. It turned from disappointment. It turned from depression for these guys. That was their natural way of looking at things. In their natural sight, they were bummed out. They were losers. They were distressed. They were freaked out. Nothing has worked out like it's supposed to. Everything's going to pieces. Nothing's happening, right? Amen. And then turn back to God, to the Spirit, to the Holy Ghost and fire. And their eyes were open. And they knew him. And he vanished. And they said one to another, "Did our heart burn?" They're not talking about heartburn. They're talking about just the very me of me was like lit up. Was on fire with this truth. Praise the Lord. The veil was removed. Just like Moses, he comes on them and they can't look at him. Right? They couldn't look at him with their minds the way they were, so he puts a veil over himself. Amen? The shattered tablets were put back together. Amen? He told them
He opened the scriptures to them. He removed the veil. Praise the Lord. Exodus 13, verses 8 and 9. And I want to get us to the place we're no longer fearful of the times that we're living in. We're no longer afraid of the book of Revelations. And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, this is done because of that which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of Egypt. And it shall be for a sign unto thee upon thine hand, and for a memorial between thine eyes, that the Lord's law may be in thy mouth. For with a strong hand hath the Lord brought thee out of Egypt. If you can go back to verse 8 just quickly. And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying. How are you going to show him? By saying. Tell it, is what he's saying. Tell it how? In a book. Right? The Torah, or for us, the Bible. I want you to tell this. I want you to say it. How am I going to say it? Say it in a book. The key to understanding the Bible is the key to understanding any book. You have to get one question right from the beginning. What's the subject? What's the theme? What's the genre? It's usually obvious. I mean, like, if it's Gone with the Wind, you're not going to consider it a romantic comedy, right? If you've read Gone with the Wind. You're not going to think of the Ten Commandments, the movie or the book, an instruction manual, right? Sometimes identifying the genre can be more complicated than that. Moses, he seemed to have anticipated that. Because when he's getting ready to die, and I use that term loosely because I don't know what really happened. It just says he just was not anymore, and God took him. And, right? So I guess he died because it says he had a burying place, but you know, I'll leave that up to archaeology or somebody to figure out, or heaven. But nevertheless, he knew he was at the point where he wasn't going to be going on any further with the children of Israel, that his time here on earth was pretty well done. And it's kind of like when Jesus comes back from the dead. So Moses is near death, and here's what happens. He says, tell the people. And he says, tell the people, tell them, and here's the context, as they're about to begin life as a free people in the promised land. So it's like Jesus on the after the Pentecost, or after his resurrection, he's telling the people, he's giving them the story, he's telling them the story, but he's telling it to them as they're about to enter in to a whole different realm. Just like Moses was saying, tell them, give them this the word, give them the tablets, but let them, because everything's going to change for them. They're going into the promised land. It isn't, they're not in Egypt anymore. They're not in slavery anymore. They're not traveling to the promised land. They're now in the promised land. And that's what Jesus was saying basically to these disciples as he began to share all that the prophets and Moses and everything else. What is he? He's doing it because he knows they're about to enter in to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. They're about to enter into the finished work, into the promised land. Amen. So Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. So why? Why read the book? I mean, why? Why? Now, Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the Lord, to love the Lord, amen, and to walk in all his ways and to love him and to serve the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes which I command thee this day for your good. Now, we know Jesus fulfilled that, so we have to stay in that relationship with Jesus based on his word, because it's for our good. It's not punishment. It's not correction even. It's for your benefit. Yes. Amen? To help us deal with our challenges. Yes. To help us deal with our decisions. To help us deal with the opportunities that we'll face. So what are we supposed to do with this book, this Bible? Read it. Right? But more than that, it says, tell the story. It's the book that allows us to retell or relive the story. And that brings up two questions. Now you're beginning to see how obsessive I actually can be. Hallelujah. Why the relive? Why the re? Why the retelling? The reliving? Well, the re implies that this activity has happened before, that it's been done before, right? Remember the first two tablets? They were replaced after they were broken with the second two tablets. We're doing the act or the task of again, of re. Am I making any sense to anybody out there? Praise the Lord. We're doing this task again. But here's the issue. As adults, we rarely do something for the first time. As adults, I'm talking about. Right? I mean, most stuff we've done. Unless maybe you haven't jumped out of an airplane, which only fools would do anyway. But I'm just saying. You know, we're adults. We've done the stuff. We've lived. Right? We don't say, I re-went to work this morning. Right? I'm getting a little tired. I think I'll re-went to sleep. Right? Re-went to the bathroom? You know what I mean? Because we've done it all. It doesn't make a lot of sense to say we're going to redo it, right? But here's the first thing is, we are retelling or reliving. Now, this is where I talked about imagination. We're reliving, we're retelling the story to our young self, to our immature self, to our flesh. Hallelujah. Our self. How have I thought of failure? I talked about it already this morning a little bit. I was retelling. You know, the Lord was retelling me his word. He was retelling it to my young self, to my immature self, to my flesh self. How have I thought of revelation? When I was young. When I was immature. When I was more fleshly than I was. Things compared to now in the spirit. See, I'm a different person now. I'm not perfect, but I'm a different person than I was. I'm a different person than I was yesterday. And I'll be a different person tomorrow. See, it's about its uniqueness to my situation now. Not what it was yesterday. I have to retell it to myself because I'm different today than I was yesterday. My situation is probably different than it was yesterday. It will be different tomorrow. So I'm retelling me. See, my relationship to the physical, to the emotional, to the intellectual is different today than it was maybe not just yesterday, but a week ago, a month ago. Aging? Can I get an amen? Praise the Lord. You see what I'm saying? Maturing. Imagination. Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge. I think that's why Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me. They have pure imaginations. They can believe anything. They can imagine anything possible. This is about our imagination and relationship to God and to God's presence. We've done so much that we have a tendency to dumb God down to what we have experienced, to what has been, rather than to use our imagination for what might be, for what is possible. And that's why we have to retell this to us, because we are changing spiritually. We are maturing spiritually. God is doing things in our lives, in our circumstances, in our world, in us individually. That is, we all know. Look, I bet I could ask every one of you and you'd say, you're spiritually different than you were 6 months ago or a year ago. Things have happened to cause you to pursue things spiritually in ways that you wouldn't have or didn't care about before. So we have to retell this thing to ourselves, because we are different. Praise the Lord. In our relationship to God, to God's presence, to His presentation, how He presents Himself. That's what He just did with me 2 days ago. Hey, quit talking to me like I'm just some, you know, nice guy. I'm your daddy. Well, Lord, I've made the excuse. Well, see, my father was not like, and he told me, this is what he told me the other day, I don't care about that. I'm not interested in that. It's not an excuse. Let it go. I wasn't whining. I was just trying to make an excuse for why I'm not as open, maybe, as other people might be. Because I never had that. I never experienced that in the natural. And he said, I don't care. I'm not talking to your natural. I said, okay. I want the Hawkeyes to win. Yeah. I tell you the truth. Now, you know this is, and I said, look, Lord, I know this is selfish, and I know there's probably all kinds of other people out there. Look, I'm telling you the truth right now, and I know it sounds idiotic, but I'm going to tell it anyway. And I said, I know there's all kinds of other people out there, and they're wanting their team to win, and you love them as much as you love me, but I'm going to be like Thomas. You told me, this is what you told me. Yeah. You love me special. I'm special. So give me a victory. I know it sounds insane. There are theologians and all sorts of other religious people right now that are just shaking their head and saying, my God, and he's pastoring a church. No wonder. What a mess. No, what I did was test him. What I did was retell me a story that I can have all things. Whatever I desire, God will give me, because I am special to him. Now it shows you how selfish I can be and how self-centered and, you know, immature. But he gave it to me when it didn't look like it was going to happen. Praise the Lord. Yes, they did. Hallelujah. Thank you, Daddy. Praise God. I'm not suggesting everybody do that, because you may not be as special as I am. I'm just kidding. No, he was trying to prove a point to me, so I took advantage of it. I retold it to me in a way that I hadn't read it before. And he honored it. It's a little thing. And you can make all the, you know, analogies and so forth you want to make that, well, it was just love, or they were a better team. But to me, it was because God said, Nathan, I'm going to give you praise the Lord. That's all that matters to me. Whatever you think is your business. Praise God. His miracles, the possibilities. Now here's what I want to show you to get to the end of this. Revelation. There are hardly anybody reads Revelation that doesn't come away from it being a little anxious. And we're hearing more and more stuff coming from there now. Everybody's, this is the end. This is the end. Right? Apocalypse Now. Anybody see that movie? That played in the background. Well, Revelation. Well, let's read Revelation 1:1 quickly. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. We rarely think of it that way. We think of it as the revelation of horror shows. You know, giant bugs the size of Volkswagens flying around and all kinds of other horror stories. And death, destruction, and so forth. Revelation of Jesus Christ. Well, that word revelation in the Greek, the way it was written initially, was apocalypse. A word that that brings fear. A word that brings, you know, anxiety to the flesh, to the immature. Because it sounds like the destruction of the world. Apocalypse? You know, it's like the old joke. Apocalypse. And the guy says, man, oh man. He said, don't worry, it's not the end of the world. But it is the end of the world. Right? Praise the Lord. It's like a little thing I heard last night, too. Just, I heard it about a dozen times because it was on I don't even know what it was on now. But the guy's standing out front and he says, ask me what's the most important thing about comedy. Ask me what's the most important. Timing. So, anyway, you had to be there. But anyway, apocalypse. It causes fear, causes anxiety, causes us to freak out and think, oh my God, where are we going to be in all of this? I mean, all these horror things happening, devils coming, things flying, all this stuff. It's just like Lot's daughters. You know, they did what they did because they thought this is the end of the world. Why did they think it was the end of the world? Because it was all that they could see with their natural eyes. All they could see was what was happening right there in Sodom. They couldn't see beyond that. So as far as they were concerned, this is it. The whole world is going under. We're done. It's over, right? Amen? They interpreted their limited vision to be the total results, the fulfillment of everything. Amen? They interpreted it to be destruction. They interpreted the broken tablets to be the end of everything. Amen? But there are another set of tablets coming. There is remission. The Greek word apokalypsis is actually the word. It's two words that come from two root words, apo, which means away or to remove, and kalypsis, which means a veil or a cover. So apocalypse is exactly what John described it as. It's the removing of a veil. It's a revelation. It's not total destruction. It's giving you eyes to see. The word speaks of the revealing, the opening of a vision. Man, I want to be in apocalypse. Give me apocalypses. I'll take it right now because I want clear vision. I want to see in the Spirit. I want to see what God is really doing. It's not to be afraid of. We should reach for it. We should be reaching out to receive it. Amen? Praise God. It's the opening of a vision concerning the end. So when you get to the end of the Bible, the end of the apocalypse, what you find, and this blows my mind, you find a bride and a bridegroom. You find a wedding. Oh my God! Some of those scared me, but not that much. Praise the Lord. I've had to do a few weddings. But in ancient Hebrew, in a Hebrew wedding, on the wedding day, when the bride and groom meet, after they've been separated for some time, they stand face to face. And the bride lifts her veil from her face. She removes that veil. The apocalypse. The apocalypse. And the two stand there. No veils. No separation. Face to unveiled face. Two sets of tablets. We're all headed for an apocalypse. Everybody on this planet is headed for an apocalypse. But there's two different apocalypses. There's an unveiling of the apocalypse of judgment. Or there's the unveiling of the apocalypse of a wedding. Depending on your view. Depending on your vision. If we're at the wedding, we ought to be coming before Him now. We ought to be loving Him now. We ought to be removing our veil right now so that He can see us and we can see Him as we really are. No more separations. No more hiding. Come as we are. That's the only way that we can really know Him as He is. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. It's the last scripture and I'll close it. 2 Corinthians 3, 18. For we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of God. Need to take the veil off early so that we can be transformed while we can still have an impact here. Because there's a lot of people whose apocalypse, whose revelation is not looking good. Ours, good thing. We got nothing to fear. We're just going to be with our lover, our Lord, our Savior, our God. But others, they're not facing remission. They're facing judgment. Couldn't be more horrible. Without us being the reflection of Him, they have no alternative. Without us being seen as He is seen, and without us being changed into that same image, they will not see Him. They don't have this to retell. They have is what they can see, and it looks like destruction. And what did Lot's daughters do? Something really stupid that caused nothing but chaos and confusion from then on. And that's what we're seeing happening in the world right now. That's what Tim and Leah saw at Walmart. Some scared boys trying to act brave because they sense an apocalypse. And they're doing stupid stuff as a result of it. No more separations. No more hiding. Come as we are. Beyond the veil. Forgiven. Unbroken. Whole. Renewed. Mercy seat in the Ark of the Covenant, rattling around there. Amen. church in a lost world. We're made one in that ark. Accepted in the beloved in Christ. Two sets of tablets. Scripture says the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. The first were broken. The law that brought death. The second were kept by Jesus, the Spirit. So we're all going to a funeral or a wedding. Either a shroud to cover or a veil to remove. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and your neighbor as yourself. Let's remove some veils. Burn some shrouds and remove some veils. We say, give the Lord a hand this morning. Praise God. Amen. We have nothing to fear but our love. If we have love for one another, then we have a concern for those that are around us. This wasn't meant to be heavy, but it is meant to be thought-provoking and to cause you to rethink some things, retell some things, relive some things. Make a difference. We have every right to be rejoicing and excited and happy. We're going to a wedding. We're going to go have a celebration to end all celebrations. But there are people all around us that are headed for the biggest and ugliest funeral that ever took place or ever will. And we need to snatch them out of that right now and get them to the wedding feast. Amen. Praise the Lord. Remove some veils. And reveal Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. Anybody want prayer? Anybody wants to give a word or anything? Why, feel free. Right now is the time to do it. We'll pray for one another. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Yeah.
Yes, there you go. That's exactly right. That's what we never know. Like I said, we don't see ourselves the way God sees us. We've got to upgrade ourselves so that we can be everything that God called us to be. You know, when you told me that story, I just heard one similar to that the other day, not as quite as graphic, but I forget where it was. I even heard it now. But anyway, this guy, they would always go to a restaurant like IHOP or someplace. It wasn't IHOP, I don't know what it was, but it was a place like that. And they would always go there, but this one guy who was always dressed up like a warlock or a witch of some kind would come in, and he'd go sit down, and everybody would move to the other side of the restaurant because he was freaky. I mean, he was just, you know, scary. So this guy comes in, and he was, I don't know if he had preached for a local church there or whatever the deal was, but anyway, he came in,
And this guy comes in, and he's got this beard and the makeup and the long cape and weird looking and carrying his stuff. And he comes in and sets down, and everybody moves to the other side of the, pick up their trays, and they all go to the other side of the restaurant. And he said, "What's going on?" He's a witch. He's a warlock. He's evil. He's mean. And he's, you know, he's vicious. So he gets his food, and he goes over. And he doesn't just sit down on that side of the room. He sits down at the table with the guy. And the guy looks at him, and he says, "Do you know who I am?" He said, "No." "I'm a warlock." And he said, "I'm a Christian." And he started sharing God with him. And the guy received Christ, sitting there at that table, began to weep. Why? Because everybody was afraid. Nobody would come to him and remove the veil. Nobody would come and be Jesus in that moment because they were afraid. You have to be led by the Spirit. I'm not telling people just go do stuff, but I'm telling God loves that man as much as he loves me. He wants his team to win too. Praise the Lord. I know everybody's still going to be bothered with that, but don't worry about it. Let's move on. I'm just saying there are people out here that we avoid. That's why it was so important what Peter said about Tim, and that's what I love about Tim. He is what he is. I mean, if he says, "I'm praying for you," he's going to pray for you. I don't care who you are, where you are, what the situation or anything else. And even when you do him wrong, he's more likely to pray for you then than he would had you been buddy-buddy with him. Because that's him. That's the way he is. He loves God, and he is obedient. So, you know, it had to hurt in the natural, but yet he's not responding to the natural. He's removed the veil, and he's going to be Jesus to those kids or to whoever it might be that he has to deal with, that he's been put in a situation to deal with. The easy thing would be just slap him upside the head and say, "You little punk, get on home and grow up." But he didn't do what the world would do. He did what Jesus would.
Sure.
But God is placing his lighthouses in every single area of the nation. And if we aren't going to be willing, it's like the Captain Coleman story, will you? Mm. Or are you going to say yes or you're going to say no? Because if not, God's moving on.
Right.
And so I just want to speak boldness over everybody. Yes. I want to just say rise up. When when you feel the pull of the Holy Spirit, be obedient.
Right.
And lift the veil.
We've heard for years and years of missionaries going to Africa, to third world countries, and they're seeing way more miracles. And we always say, well, that's because they have more need. No, it's because they have more faith. They're believing for miracles, and so they're getting the miracles that God would love to give us, but we're so full of ourselves, right, that we're not getting it. We need to retell this thing to ourselves to be transformed, to be who we are. And I'm telling you this right now. Look, this tent meeting, we need to be there and support this. You say, well, I'm born again. I've got the Holy Ghost. Yes, but you need to be there to encourage the people who are going from city to city, as well as to be there to pray for people that are coming, to be there to increase the presence of the Lord. So, it's not my idea. Duh. I mean, if you're waiting on my idea,
Praise the Lord. We just need to act where God gives opportunity. We need to show up. That's what this is about. And so it's true with everything. He gives you an opportunity to go sit with the guy at IHOP that looks like the biggest weirdo in the world. It may be because you're the only one that he's going to listen to.
Right?
Or your neighbor or somebody at Walmart or like with Tim and the situation there. Who knows what kind of an impact that had? Because I guarantee you what those kids have heard every time they've been a smart Alex and you know, little jerks. I can say all kinds of adjectives here. But what they're used to is, shut up, you little idiot, get out of the way, or slap across the head, and get out of the way, you little moron. You'll never amount to anything. You don't know what you're talking about. To have somebody speak love back to their hate. I guarantee you when they go home and crawl into their little whatever they got to sleep in at night, they're going to be thinking, it's weird, I wonder why that guy, he's a big guy, he could have, all it would have taken is one blow, really.
Yeah.
I mean, that hand, he could have wiped all three of them out. But he didn't. He showed compassion. He showed mercy. If that ain't Jesus showing up in the middle of a mess, I don't know what is. So that's where we're at. And you know, God will put us in situations and circumstances. It's comical because Sally was it Walmart you were at? Costco. And a couple of young teenagers are there. And she's got an arm full of groceries because she didn't get a cart. I think it was for sympathy reasons, to get you further in the life. That's just my opinion. No, anyway, but they had a cart full of stuff too. And they said, are you ready? And she said, yeah. They said, well, go ahead. So it's the difference. You know what I'm saying? These kids don't represent every kid, but they represent some kids. These kids, a whole different environment. They were probably raised in a completely different environment where they were shown compassion, they were shown love, they were shown respect, and so they're acting out of it. These kids are a product of their own, you know, their own environment. It doesn't make them evil. It just, what was fed into them is what's kind of come out. And somebody's got to be able to say, you know, God loves you. And what better person to do it than Tim, especially in that circumstance, in that situation. That's what that was. That was a revelation of Jesus right there, unveiled. So, yeah, we need to support whatever God is doing. We need to be part of it. We need to act now. We've been given a space here. I don't know. I'm not a, you know, a seer. I'm just saying, in my mind, knowing all the things that are happening, we could say the end could be tomorrow. Well, I don't know. It could be. Could have been yesterday, for that matter. But I'm saying we've been given some space here for revival,
yes,
to act, to move.
Yes. Yes.
And if we don't do it, judgment for sure is going to come. So we're seeing judgment already all over the earth. But judgment brings redemption as well and remission. So we need to act while the fire is hot, so to speak. Go ahead.
So I've got a one of the prophets of the Lord told me to follow. He had died on the operating table when he went to the Lord. And he said what the judgment was for a Christian was, as he stood before the Lord, is he saw what his life could have been in Jesus and saw what he actually did.
Yeah.
How he didn't measure up. He said, the Lord continued to look at him
all got to, again, call it what you want, man up, woman up, spirit up, Jesus up. We just got to start being what we have been created to be, and for such a time as this, we were placed here. What you said, Suzanne, or excuse me, what you said, Sheila, is true of all of us, and that's what I'm talking about. This consciousness of the Spirit is what. And look, I've been praying this for 6 months now, and I know only because God has drawn me to pray this, and that is to be conscious of His presence every minute, to always be aware of His and my oneness. It's for that very reason, because look, it happens to all of us. We look back and we go, oh my God. Was an opportunity. I could have prayed for him. I could have said something. I could have given him a couple of bucks, something, just whatever it was that the situation called for. But we're so, you know, veiled. We're so just kind of disconnected from who we really are. We're just so into our other person, that young person, that our imagination. That's why we need to be retelling it, because that thing still exists. Right? And it's got to be brought up. It's kind of the renewing of your mind, if you want to call it that. It's just another way of looking at it. But it's a way of bringing me in sync so that my natural man is obedient to the spirit man, so that he thinks the same way they think. It operates the same way, so that when I have that opportunity, I don't 10 minutes later go, darn, that was a perfect opportunity. You know what I mean? Because it happens. So that when I see it, I know it for what it is at the moment that I see it. For these people, because there's others around here that we may not have actually had physical sight of, but yet God is dealing with it. Yeah. So we need to be praying for God's, you know, His grace to reach out to them and for them to feel comfortable, to feel like, hey, I can go there, it'll be okay. You know, nobody's going to make a fool out of me or embarrass me or whatever. So make it a safe place, a comfortable place that they can feel like, yeah, let's go give it a shot. God bless you. Have a great week. Take advantage of every opportunity He gives. Just see the rewards come. Praise God. You're dismissed.